I am Brother Stephen Elabo, welcoming you to Deeper Life Bible Church, Charlottesville, United States, a place where the undiluted Word of God is being preached. You are about to listen to our General Superintendent, Pastor W.F. Kumoye, as he comes forth to share the mind of God with you and your family. I want you to be ready. Pick up your pen and your paper and jot down important messages as they will do you good. God bless you and remain blessed.
I chapter 1. We're doing something we have probably not done before, because it's a new year, it's a new approach, it's a new life, and everything is turning around in your life in Jesus' name. I'm going to look at Malachi chapter 1 today. We're going to try and cover the whole chapter. And this chapter talks about a God demanding something from the people of God, because he wants to do something special for us. He calls us into a special relationship. And as we look at Malachi chapter 1, I'm talking about giving God our best for his best. Giving God our best for his best. If we're going to have the best from God, he requires too that we will reciprocate. That is, we'll do what we expect him to do. He loves us. He wants us to love him. He wants to bless us. He wants us to be a blessing unto his holy name as well. He wants to give the best to us. And he wants us to give our very best, giving God our best for his best. As I told you, we're looking at Malachi. Look at Malachi chapter 1, and I'm reading from verse 1. It says, the burden of the word of the Lord to Israel by Malachi. Stop there for a moment. As you look at Malachi, you know, it's the last book of the Old Testament. And our message today is coming from the first chapter of the last book. And as you look at this book, I'm choosing this book because there's something here. Number one, it's a covenant book. It's a covenant book. And at this day of our covenant month, it's good to go to this book and see, how can you have the best in this covenant month? How can you have the best in this covenant year? How can you have the best at this beginning of the rest of your life? It is a covenant book. Look at chapter 2. In chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 5. It says, my covenant was with him of life and peace. My covenant was with him of life and peace. I want you to look at verse chapter 1, chapter 3, and verse 1. Chapter 3, verse 1. It says, behold, I will send my messenger, and he shall prepare the way before me, and the Lord whom ye seek shall suddenly come to his temple. I said, the Lord whom ye seek shall suddenly come to his temple, even the messenger of the covenant. So, as you look at this book, it's a covenant book. Not only that, number two, it is a connecting book. As we look at Malachi, it's looking to the past, and then it's looking to the future, and it's standing like he holds the past, and then he looks at the future, because it's a connecting book. And this year, this is a connecting month for you. You will connect with God. You will connect with power. You'll connect with his provision. That's why we're coming to this. One, a covenant book. And two, a connecting book. Look at chapter 4. I mean, in verses 5 and 6. It says, behold, I will send unto you Elijah, the prophet, before the coming and of the great day and the dreadful day of the Lord. And he shall turn the heart of the fathers unto the children, and the heart of the children to their fathers, lest I smite, let I come and smite the earth, the world, with a curse. He's looking forward. But look at verse 4. Remember ye the law of Moses, my servant. As he looks to the past, he looks to the future. And he says, it is a connecting book. And that's why we're looking at this, because this year, there'll be a connection in your life. Connection with God. Connection with power. Connection with the promises of God. And connection with all the goodness of God in your life, in Jesus' name. A covenant book. A connecting book. It's a consoling book. All the sorrows of the past will go away. All the poverty of the past will go away. There's consolation this year. There is comfort this year. Look at the middle part of chapter 3. I'm reading from verse 10. It says, prove me now herewith, if, says the Lord, if I will not open the windows of heaven and then pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it. It's telling us that this year, consolation has come. It will wipe your tears away, and it will take all your sorrows and all the need of your life. Solution has come in Jesus' name. Well, a covenant book, and then a connection book, and then a consoling book. And let's look at them one by one now. In chapter 1, chapter 1 talks about the burden of entreaty. The burden of entreaty. Here the prophet has a burden. He says, Israel is loved by God. It's a special people unto God. You are a peculiar believer, a peculiar child of God. You are like no other child. God has given you a peculiar place in the kingdom. And I pray that that peculiarity, you will not miss it in Jesus' name. And as Malachi saw the people of God, he saw that the peculiarity was kind of fading away. They were just like all the other nations, and they were asking themselves, where's our privilege? Where's our peculiarity? Where's our uniqueness? That's why chapter 1 is dealing with the burden of entreaty. Look at chapter 1, verse 1. It says, the burden of the word of the Lord to Israel by Malachi. And then chapter 2 is talking about the behavior in its in view of eternity. Malachi says, you're wondering about your peculiarity. That's why I have a burden for you. You're wondering about your uniqueness. That's why I'm having a burden for you. It says, can you think about your behavior in view of eternity? Look at chapter 2, verse 6. In chapter 2, verse 6, it says the law of truth was in his mouth. Iniquity was not found in his lips. He walked with me in peace and equity. And then he goes on to say, and did turn many away from iniquity. He said, that's what I appreciated in you, Israel. That's what I appreciated in you, the people of God, the behavior in view of eternity. He said, the burden I'm having now for the children of Israel is that they were kind of slowly going away from that center and from that behavior in view of eternity. Then it comes to chapter 3. He said, we can reconnect again. We can plug in again, and we can come into the blessing in its entirety. Blessing in its entirety. It says, it's not lost yet. Something new is coming. Are you there? It said, something new is coming. Look at chapter 3. In chapter 3, I'm reading here from the middle of verse 10. It says, put me now here, we says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, an outpouring is coming. Somebody there said, an outpouring is coming, that there shall not be room enough to receive it, and I will rebuke the devourer for your sakes. And he shall not destroy the fruit of your ground, neither shall your vine cast her fruit before the time in the field, says the Lord of hosts, and all nations shall call you blessed. Turn that you into me, and all nations shall call me blessed. Say that again, and all nations shall call me blessed, for ye shall be a delightsome land, says the Lord of hosts. Chapter 1 is talking about the burden of entreaty. Chapter 2 is talking about the behavior in view of eternity. Chapter 3 is talking about the blessing in its entirety. And then chapter 4 is talking about the beginning of the end. The beginning of the end. I want you to look at chapter 4, verses 5 and 6. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And it shall turn the heart of the fathers unto the children, and the heart of the children unto the fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse. Something new is going to begin. A new provision, and a new promotion, and a new power is going to come in your life in Jesus' name. As we look at this, talking about giving our best, giving our very best for his best. The Lord wants us to have the best, but before then, he wants you to also understand, you must be born again. You are born again, you come to the Lord and you are a child of God. All the past is gone, now you face a new direction. You face a new destiny. Sins confessed and sins forsaken, and then you become a real child of God. What did you give to the Lord at that time? For him to give you the very best salvation. You give your heart, you give your life, you give your mind. You say, Jesus, I give my heart to you. Jesus, I give my heart to you. Jesus, I give my future to you. Jesus, I give my destiny to you. And because you give your heart to the Lord, then you understood, you give Jesus Christ for you on the cross of Calvary. You give Jesus Christ for you to be your Savior and your Lord. And it is sealed in Jesus' name. Well, don't stop there. If you're going to keep on getting the best from the Lord, you say, Lord, I lay my everything on the altar again. I consecrate myself. I surrender myself. My heart, my life, everything I've got, I lay it on the altar. It is that absolute surrender. All to Jesus, I surrender. All to him, I freely give. I will ever love and trust him. And in his will, I will always obey. I surrender all. I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all. That's why you were sanctified. He sanctified you. He purified you. He purged you. And then your soul became totally different. Something new happened again. I'm saved. I'm sanctified. He said, don't go away yet. There is a power. Power is coming upon your life. Somebody there said, power is coming upon your life. It's the power of the Holy Ghost. And he says, tarry ye in Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high. There are many people that go through life. They say, I'm born again. They say, I'm saved. They say, I'm sanctified. Holy Ghost power, supernatural power, the dynamite of the heaven coming upon your soul. That dynamite will come upon your soul. If you have been saved so many years and been sanctified so many years and only holiness, holiness, but no power this year, you'll have the power of God. I said you'll have the power of God. And then it says you tarry in Jerusalem. It says, for ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria to the uttermost part of the earth. You'll have it in Jesus' name. And after you've had those great Christian experiences, you don't stop there. You keep on in your family devotion, your personal devotion, in learning the word of God and living by the word of God. You keep on giving your very best unto God. And as you give your very best unto God, the best will keep on coming to you every time in Jesus' name. And so you make it a response to the Lord. A responsibility to the Lord that you're always giving and he is always giving. You're always giving and he is always giving. And that's how you're going to spend this year. And what a wonderful year is going to be for you in Jesus' name. Giving God our best for his best. We're looking at 3 points. Number one, the confirmation of passionate compassion for the sons of God. The confirmation of passionate compassion for the sons of God. Number two, we're looking at the condemnation of polluted, contemptible sacrifices for God. The condemnation of polluted, contemptible sacrifices for God. The children of Israel at this time, they were offering things to God that were not acceptable to God. It was polluted. And it was contemptible. And God said he wasn't going to receive that from them. And that is why temporarily they were not receiving the very best from God. Number three now is consecration of pure, commendable service to God. He wants us to come back again. You are coming back again. Somebody there, I can't hear you. I say you are coming back again. And you come back to giving everything you've got, your very best unto God. Come back to number one. What's number one? Tell me there. Confirmation of passionate compassion for the sons of God. We're looking at Malachi chapter 1. I'm reading from verse 1. It says, the burden of the word of the Lord to Israel by Malachi. I have loved you, says the Lord. Yet you say, wherein have I loved you? As have you loved us? It says, was not Esau Jacob's brother, says the Lord, yet I loved Jacob. That's the confirmation of love for Jacob. The confirmation of love for Jacob. The confirmation of love for Jacob. He wants to confirm to you how much he loves you. He wants to confirm to you. And he says, look at the things I'm doing in your life. And look at from the moment before you were saved to the moment you were saved. And to the moment you have been following the Lord until this time. The confirmation of love for Jacob. Let's look at verses 3 and 4. It says, and I hated Esau. What? And I hated Esau and laid his mountains and his heritage ways for the dragons of the wilderness. And what the Lord means here is that he had less love, limited love for Esau. Yeah, I'll explain that to you later. You see, the love God had for Esau almost looked like, what are you doing to me? What are you doing for me? It looks like something limited. And because of that, it's like hatred. You remember Jacob himself, he had, those two women in his life. And the way he appeared and the way he loved Rebecca and the love she had for Leah was like, it's like, you hate me. Because that's comparison. It's like when Jesus Christ said, if you're going to follow me, you will love me more than your father and your mother. And then he uses the word hatred for that. It's not hatred of bitterness. It's not the hatred of antagonism. It's not the hatred of punishment. It's the hatred of comparison. That is, you love Jacob so much, and the love you have for me is like, it's like hatred. It says in verse 4, whereas Edom says, we are impoverished, but we will return and build the desolate places, says the Lord. Of course, then he says, they shall build, but I will throw down. That's the meaning of the hatred there. It says, I'm going to judge them because they are not giving themselves to me and they're running away from me. Therefore, I'm going to judge them and they shall be called the border of wickedness, the people against whom the Lord has indignation forever. That is consideration of less love for Esau. The consideration of less love for Esau. And then verse 5 tells us, and your eyes shall see. Your eyes will see something. I said your eyes will see something. You will see blessing this year. You see the glory of God this year. It says your eyes shall see. And ye shall say the Lord will be magnified from the border of Israel. The Lord will be magnified from the border of Israel. Look at that section that we're referring to as a confirmation of passionate compassion for the sons of God. How do you become a child of God? You leave the things of the world. You leave your sins, all the sins you had before, because all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Then you say, I come to the Lord. I look at Calvary. I look at what he has done for me. I accept, I believe, I receive, I trust. And because I trust in Jesus Christ who died for me, then you become a child of God. As many as received him, to them he gave power to become the sons of God, even to them that believed on his name. And the Lord is showing you that as you trust him like Jacob trusted him, like Jacob believed in him, he was a supplanter before. He was a sinner before. But now he came to the Lord. He said, Lord, I believe. Lord, I believe. I believe you, I trust you. And this place where I've rested today, I didn't know it's the gate of heaven. Your salvation, that's the gate of heaven.